Come learn how to take your existing Azure SQL database using Entity Framework Core and EF Core Power Tools. Learn all about it this week on Data Exposed MVP Edition. Hi, I'm Anna Hoffman, and welcome to this episode of Data Exposed MVP Edition. Today, I'm joined with Microsoft Most Valuable Professional, Erik. Erik, thanks so much for joining us today. Can you kick us off by telling us a little bit about what you do?
Yeah, I work as a consultant in the IT industry, and I help customers develop solutions in Azure Cloud, often involving some kind of data storage like Azure SQL Database, occasionally table storage, occasionally Cosmos DB. And I've been a Microsoft MVP for a number of years. And one of the reasons I bid that, I suppose, is because I provided some free tools and libraries that can help bridge the gap between .NET developers and the data platform.
Awesome. Cool. Well, it's great to have you on the show. I am familiar with some of the tools that you have out on GitHub, so we'll make sure to share those in the description. But today we're going to be talking about how to get started with Azure SQL Database using EF Core, and we're going to do it in 5 minutes. So
my optimistic approach, but let's see how far we can get in 5 minutes. I will tell you when I actually start the demo. I will just do a little bit of introduction, starting with explaining what does EF in EF Core actually stand for. And it means Entity Framework, and it's a .NET library for data access. It's Microsoft's recommended library in .NET for data access, in particular against the relational sources like Azure SQL Database, SQL Server, Postgres, MySQL. A lot of other database providers are available for the product, but those are the main ones.
Okay, cool. No, that's definitely good to know. Just make sure everyone's aware what we're even talking about.
Absolutely, yes. And this little demo I will show will demonstrate one of the tools that I have created. It's a Visual Studio extension called EF Core Power Tools. Which will allow you to point to an existing database, which can be hosted on Azure SQL Database or on SQL Server on premises or in a VM, and then generate a code so you can start interacting with that database from a .NET application. So by doing that, it will help a lot of, it will get you started quickly, and you can concentrate on improving your API documentation and on your business logic rather than the plumbing of accessing the database.
Awesome, great. Well, let's take a look and let's say
let's now. the 5 minutes have gone already, yes. Let's just have a quick look at what we can do. I will just start with presenting my screen here. I have a blog post about what is new in the tool, and it has actually just nearly reached 250,000 installations. So that's quite a milestone. And it's a free Visual Studio extension. It's available in Visual Studio Marketplace, and it's completely free. And it runs with any edition of Visual Studio, including the free Community Edition. It's open source and available on GitHub, and I get a lot of feedback, bug reports and so on GitHub, and then welcome anybody using the tool to interact with me via GitHub. What we're going to look at today is basically what is in this article here that I'm showing, Reverse Engineering Quick Start, which will show very quickly how to get started using the tool by pointing to an existing database. So I will switch to Visual Studio. I have created a new solution here, and I have a project, .NET 6 project. There's nothing in it at the moment except just a stop program CS. And now I will connect this this application is just a simple console app, but it could be like my data access library in a web API or similar. I will now connect that to my SQL database and generate an EF core code base that I can interact with in this app from my SQL database. So I will just right click my project here, and I have the tool installed already. It's called EF Core Power Tools, and I will go to reverse engineer menu. And then I will connect to my database. I have already connected, added a connection to an SQL database, but let's just look at the mechanics of doing this. So I go in here, I pick SQL database, I call it something, and I have a sample here that will give you some ideas how you should compose your connection string. The reason why I'm doing this and not just pointing to it from Visual Studio is due to the fact that Visual Studio does, if you're using a username and password, and I really like my connections to be password list and based on Active Directory. So this is the format of the connection string you will be using in order to connect to a database. But as I mentioned, I have already created a connection here to my live database that I have established in Azure portal. I will click OK here. So the tool will now go out and look in the database for all the tables, views, stored procedures, and functions that are in the table, in the database, sorry. And I will just choose to just include everything here. So I can point to my tables and get them generated as C# classes and similar level views. I can also map stored procedures and SQL Server stored procedures and functions with the tool and use those via my EF Core code. So I will click OK, choosing everything. We have some options here. I will just leave most of them as standard. I have an extensive user guide on GitHub that you can consult for more information about all these options. I will choose to include the connection string in this case so we can do a quick demo. And I can also pluralize my object names, meaning that if I have a table called customer, it will become customers and so on. And as you can see, we can also install the appropriate provider package in the project. So I just need to click OK, and immediately I can start coding against the database. Was that less than 5 minutes, Anna?
Yeah, it was. I think from start to finish, that was about 4 minutes, maybe even less. So it's pretty awesome.
Cool. But let's see if the demo gods are with us today, and click OK here. So now, managed to click OK, and you can see that a lot of files have been added to the project, which is code generated for all the objects in the database. And we can start program CS and start using the code that was just generated. I think it's just a bit changed here. So the code is now exposed via something called a DB context, and it's named after the name of the database that we used by default. So I can write queries now in C# using a C# feature called language integrated query and access the database like that. And I have not stored any credentials on my machine because I was using Active Directory authentication.
Awesome, cool. This is really great to see. One question that I have is, what happens as you go to like make changes to these tables or add new tables? How do you update that here?
That's a really good question, Anna. One approach is that all the code is generated in what is called partial classes. So you can actually extend these classes. So if you need to modify these classes, like say, add a property to the order details for a display name or something like that, you can do that in a separate file that's separate from this code generated file. Another approach that I'm a big fan of is that you can actually use a database project to keep your schema under source control and evolve that using the database project. which is basically a collection of create scripts that you keep under source control. And the tool has the ability to point to a database project. I will just show it here. And we can actually create a context and maintain the context based on what is in the database project. And I think that's a really good approach to managing the lifetime of your database project, because then you can deploy your code and your database project, which essentially becomes a .pack file, at the same time when you're updating your app with new features.
Awesome, cool. That's a really great combination of two awesome technologies. One final question I have is, let's say you're managing this for multiple schemas or customers, like, do you have any advice for how you might go about using this to do that?
If you're manning it for multiple schemas, the tool already support that. So it will there's a feature where you can generate classes into separate folders named after the schemas. So if you're overlapping, if you have a school.customer or an order.customer, whatever, multiple schemas with the same table name, the tool can separate them by namespace by doing that for you. But you're also talking about how you're managing it in terms of addressing various customer needs or what?
Yes.
Yeah, so then you would probably start having different versions, but everything that we see here is under source control. So that's definitely one way of managing that, because the code and the database schema in this context where we're using the dark pack goes together, so you can branch out and have variations for individual customers.
Awesome. Cool. Well, Erik, thanks so much for coming on the show. Like, I personally learned a lot. Haven't seen a ton of EF Core personally myself. I know I am, kind of a rare breed in that case, but I know a lot of folks are out there using Entity Framework. And even if they're not, maybe this is a good sign to kind of take advantage of some of the tools and capabilities like you showed off here today. So thanks so much for coming on the show. We'll put some links in the description so folks can go learn more, get access to these tools, and start in under 5 minutes with Azure SQL Database. To our viewers, if you like this episode, go ahead, give it a like, subscribe to our channel, leave us a comment, and let us know what you think. And we hope to see you next time on Data Exposed.